Welcome to Deeksha Online. Today we are going to discuss some questions from thermodynamics and thermochemistry. Let us take the first question. The sublimation energy of iodine is 57.3. Enthalpy of fusion is 15.5. What is the enthalpy of vaporization of the iodine? So sublimation enthalpy is given. Enthalpy of fusion is given. Enthalpy of vaporization we have to find out. The relation between these three is enthalpy of sublimation. Enthalpy of sublimation is equal to enthalpy of fusion. Enthalpy of fusion plus it is enthalpy of vaporization. Enthalpy of vaporization here. So sublimation means solid substance directly changes into gaseous state. Hence contains two steps in that. A fusion as well as vaporization. Now sublimation enthalpy is given as 57.3. So this is 57.3, which is equal to fusion is given as 15.5 plus vaporization we have to find out. Therefore the value of x is equal to 57.3 minus it is 15.5, which comes out to be 41.8. So many kilojoules we have. 41.8 kilojoules. So option is answer A. So sublimation is given by fusion plus vaporization. So option A is correct. Next. When freezing of liquid takes place in a system. Freezing of liquid takes place in a system. Then freezing is an exothermic process. Freezing is exothermic process. Freezing is exothermic, energy is given off and therefore Q will be less than 0. So therefore Q will be less than 0. Option is B we have. So option B. 2 moles of zinc dissolved in HCl. 2 moles of zinc dissolved in HCl at 25 degrees Celsius. The work done in the open vessel. The work done in the open vessel. Now work done is basically given by minus P delta V can be also taken as minus RT delta N. Delta N comes from the reaction between reactants and products. Let us take reaction between zinc plus HCl giving rise to ZnCl2 plus H2. So in this reaction, except hydrogen, remaining all means zinc is a solid substance. HCl will be aqueous, zinc chloride also in aqueous solution we have. So only H2 is a gaseous component we have. Therefore the value of delta N will be equal to 1. Delta N is equal to 1 for 1 mole of a zinc. So for 1 mole of a zinc, delta N is equal to 1. Since there are 2 moles of zinc involving, delta N value will be equal to 2. So for 2 moles of zinc, 2 moles of zinc, delta N value is equal to 2. Now, applying the formula, that is, you are asking us open vessel. So, work is equal to minus RT delta N. So, minus RT, so minus 8.314 into T. T is given as 298 Kelvin, RT delta N. And this value will be in joules, which comes out to be minus 4955 joules by 1000. So value will be equal to minus 4.955. So many kilojoules we have. So answer is B option. In this case, answer is coming out to be minus 4.955. So formula to be used is minus P delta V or else minus delta N RT. And delta N comes from the equation. So answer is B here. Then which of the indicated relationship is correct for the following exothermic reaction carried out at constant pressure? Which of the indicated relationship is correct? Means we should know the relation between delta H and delta E then now. Now delta H is equal to delta E plus delta N RT. delta E plus delta N RT or RT delta N. Now here depends upon relation between delta H, delta E depends upon the sign of delta N then. In this reaction, the value of delta N, the value of delta N is equal to number of moles of gaseous, number of moles of gaseous products, we have 2 here, minus number of moles of gaseous reactants, we have only 4 here now. Therefore, value of delta N is equal to minus 2. When delta N is equal to negative value, then delta H must be less than delta E. Delta H must be less than delta R. We can say delta E is more than delta H. So option B is correct. So formula is delta H is equal to delta E plus delta N RT you have. So answer is option B. Then for the reaction FeCO3 giving rise to FeO and CO2, delta H is 82.8 kilojoules at 25 degrees Celsius. What is the delta U value? So we require relationship between once again delta H and delta U. Now delta H is equal to delta U plus it is RT delta N. Coming towards value of delta N here. Value of delta N is equal to, in this reaction only CO2 is a gaseous component we have. So therefore it is a delta N is equal to 1 here. Delta N is 1 in the reaction. Now delta H value is given to us, that is 82.8, which is equal to delta U, we have to calculate delta U plus value of R, that is 8.314. Let us take in kilojoules, so I'm dividing by 1000 here. R T, T is given as 298 and delta N is equal to 1. Therefore delta U is equal to 82.8. it, the value, this value simplification comes out to be minus, it is a 2.477. therefore finally delta U is equal to 80.32. we have 80.32, option is B. So formula is delta H is equal to delta U plus delta N RT, delta N RT or RT delta N. Delta N value comes from the equation given to us. Delta N is found to be equal to 1. Substituting the values, we get the value of delta U. Now, so answer is B option. Next, sixth one. What amount of energy is released in kilojoules in the combustion of 5.8 grams of butane? In the combustion of 5.8 grams of butane, what is the amount of energy released? Now here, if you see the reaction, 2 moles is giving rise to 5756 kilojoules of energy. Let us convert the mass given to us in terms of moles. For that, you require molar mass of butane. So molar mass of C4H10, it comes out to be 58. Molar mass is 58. Therefore, number of moles will be equal to, number of moles will be equal to, mass is 5.8, molar mass is 58. Therefore, we have 0.1 moles of butane we have. Now from the equation we can say that, from this we can say that 2 moles of C4H10 gives rise to, it is 5756 kilojoules of energy. Therefore 0.1 mole of butane, 1 mole of butane gives rise to how much? So 0.1 into, it is 5756 by which comes out to be 287.8. So 287.8 on calculation. Therefore the answer is 287.8, means when you take so many grams of butane, we are going to get required amount of energy for this. They are going to get required amount of energy. When you take 5.8 grams of butane gives rise to 287.8 kilocalories of energy, kilojoules of energy. Once again, 2 moles of butane gives rise to 5756 kilojoules of energy. Therefore, 5.8 grams gives how much? We have converted 5.8 grams into moles. It came up to 0.1 mole. So, 2 moles of butane gives 5756 kilojoules of energy. Therefore, 0.1 mole gives how much amount of energy? On simplification, we got 287.8, so many kilojoules of energy. So, option is B. Next one. The heat of formation of ammonia is minus 46 kilojoule per mole. Delta H in kilojoules per mole of the reaction 2NH3 giving rise to N2 plus 3H2 we have. So heat of formation of ammonia is given as minus 46 here. And we require the heat of reaction, the heat of the following reaction, that is 2NH3 giving rise to N2 plus 3H2. So now here heat of formation means one mole of compound must be formed. That is N2 plus 3/2H2 giving rise to NH3. Delta H value, this is given as minus 46. This is called heat of formation because one mole of ammonia is being formed. They're asking us now dissociation of ammonia. So reverse is being asked. That too for 2 moles is being asked. So reverse reaction means we need to change the sign. Numerical value remains same, but sign must have changed. That too for 2 moles, so it must be multiplied by 2. So changing the sign, that will be 46 plus 46, and multiplying 2, you are going to get 92. So 92 is the answer. So they are given heat of formation, asking us heat of dissociation. So sign will be different, numerical value will be same. Since they are asking for 2 moles, it must be multiplied by 2. Therefore, 46 into 2, that comes out to be 92. Option is C. So C option. Then, the latent heat of vaporization of liquid is liquid at 500 Kelvin and 1 atmosphere is 10 kilocalories per mole. Latent heat of vaporization of liquid at 500 Kelvin, 1 atmosphere is 10 kilocalories per mole. What will be the change in internal energy delta U for 3 moles of same liquid at same temperature? They are asking us delta U value for 3 moles of liquid. They are giving us latent heat of vaporization of the liquid now. Now here the value is given for 1 mole. Therefore for 3 moles the same value comes out to be 30 then now. For 3 moles the value comes out to be 30. Now for this reaction will be in this form, that is H2O, something like H2O liquid changing into vapor phase, say H2O like gaseous phase here now. Because liquid is changing into the gaseous state, like water changes into the vapor phase we have. Here, they are asking for 3 moles. So, it will be 3 and then 3 in this case. Therefore, delta N value for the process will be equal to 3. Delta N is equal to 3 in this case. Now, the relation delta H is equal to delta U plus it is RT delta N we have. So, they are given the value of delta H. 10. This 10 stands for only 1 mole of a gas. So 3 moles are involved here. So value will be equal to 30 then. 30 is equal to delta U you require. It is plus R value. R value is equal to 2 because the answer given in kilocalories. So 2 by 1000 into value of T. So value of T is given as 500 here. And then delta N value is equal to 3 we have. Delta N value is equal to 3. So therefore, delta U will be equal to, this is 30 minus, simplification of this gives rise to 3. This implies the value is equal to 27. So answer is option C we have, option C, 27. So here we considered 3 moles of, they are given 3 moles of some liquid. It's something like 3 moles of water liquid become 3 moles of gaseous component. Delta N is equal to 3, we applied formula. Delta H is equal to delta U plus RT delta N. So answer is found to be 27. Then that is option C. Then comes 9th one. What is the melting point of benzene if delta H of fusion is given and delta H of fusion and delta S of fusion are given to us. Delta H of fusion and then delta S of fusion are given to us. Now the formula is Entropy of fusion is equal to enthalpy of fusion by temperature. That is a melting point we have. So now we require the temperature. What is the melting point? So we require temperature. So temperature can be given by here enthalpy of fusion by entropy of fusion. This is entropy, sorry. So enthalpy of fusion by this will be entropy of fusion, which is equal to the value of enthalpy of fusion is 9.95. I am writing 10 to the power of 3 because this value is given in joules here, divided by 35.7. Approximately the value comes out to be 278.7. So formula for entropy of fusion is enthalpy of fusion by temperature, and therefore temperature is given by, that is, enthalpy of fusion by entropy of fusion. Both should be in same units. So they are given this value in kilojoules. So we multiply it into 10 to the power of 3. Hence the value comes out to be 278.7. So option is B we have. So answer is B. So B answer. Next one. For a process that is H2O liquid, 1 bar 373 Kelvin, changing into H2O gas state, 1 bar 373 Kelvin. So conditions remain same here. Only physical state is changing from, say, liquid to gas state. The correct set of thermodynamic parameters. The correct set of thermodynamic parameters. Here, liquid is changing into gas state. That implies entropy should be positive value. Liquid changing into gaseous state, we have L liquid becoming there gaseous state. So delta S is equal to a positive value now. And when you are observing the given set of conditions here, the system should be in equilibrium state. Therefore, delta G remains zero. Excuse me. So delta, that is a liquid becoming gas. So we can say entropy is positive. And delta G is equal to zero because given set of conditions say that it is an equilibrium state. Therefore, option A is correct. So option A. Then, a system absorbs 600 joules of energy and does work equivalent to 400 joules of energy. What is the change in the internal energy of the system? System absorbs 600 joules of energy and does work equivalent to 400 joules of energy. What is the change in internal energy? Here, from first law of thermodynamics, we can say that delta E is equal to Q plus W. Here energy absorbed is 600, work was done equal to 400. Work is done by the system, therefore it will be equal to 600. Work done is equal to 400 minus N because work is done by the system. So therefore difference comes out to be 200 joules. Hence answer is option B. So direct application of first law of thermodynamics here. Then, so answer is option B we have. Next comes 12. A human body requires 2370 kilocalories of energy daily. The amount, the heat of combustion of glucose is -790 kilocalories per mole. The amount of glucose required for daily consumption. Human body requires 2370 kilocalories of energy daily, and the heat of combustion of glucose is -790 kilocalories per mole. And the amount of glucose required for daily consumption is. So therefore, we should know how much amount of glucose is required. So here, when you are observing, the amount of heat given is -790 per mole. It implies that 1 mole of glucose on combustion gives us to 790 kilocalories. Now, should know how many kilocalories we require for daily. So daily, and 1 mole means here 180 grams. Glucose is C6H12O6, therefore the molar mass comes out to be 180. So 180 grams gives rise to 790 kilocalories per mole. Energy required to is equal to 2370. Therefore 2370 kilocalories we require. For this, how much amount of glucose is required? Upon cross multiplication, 180 into 2370 by 790. Simplification, the value comes out to be 540 approximately. Therefore, you require 540 grams of glucose per day. So they are given human body requires 2370 kilocalories of energy per day. And therefore, how much amount of glucose is required? They are given molar heat of combustion of glucose also. So 1 mole gives 790 kilocalories. So means 180 grams gives 790 kilocalories. We require 2370 kilocalories. Therefore, how much amount of glucose is required? Cross multiplication, we get 540 grams. Then, so answer is option B. Then, the heat of neutralization heat of neutralization for reaction NaOH HCl is given as -57.1 joule Kelvin. Now the heat released when 0.25 moles of NaOH is treated with 0.25 moles of HCl. They are given heat of neutralization of strong acid and strong base, asking us heat given when they take 0.25 moles of the substance, 0.25 moles of the substance. Here, we define heat of neutralization always per 1 gram equivalent of base and 1 gram equivalent of acid. That is to say, NaOH plus HCl giving rise to NaCl plus H2O. When you take this 1 gram equivalent, this also 1 gram equivalent, the amount of heat given is -57.1 kilojoule per mole. We have 1 gram equivalent of NaOH means 40 grams here, and this is 36.5 grams here now. And here 1 gram equivalent of NaOH is also equal to 1 mole of NaOH, means here when you take your 1 mole of NaOH, in this case also 1 gram equivalent of HCl is also equal to 1 mole of HCl, is also 1 mole of HCl. So when you take 1 mole of NaOH and 1 mole of HCl, the heat given is equal to 57.1 kilojoules we have. Now the question they gave us 0.25 moles. If you take this as 0.25 moles, this also is 0.25 moles, how much amount of heat is given? So this value is 1/4. So therefore, it should be 57.1/4. 57.1/4 is the amount of heat liberated. So answer is 14.3. Nearly is equal to 14.3 we have. So option is C. Excuse me. So option is C here now. So we are defining the heat of neutralization for 1 gram equivalent of the substance. So in this case, 1 gram equivalent is also equal to 1 mole of substance. So 1 mole of NaOH plus 1 mole of HCl, giving rise to 57.1 kilojoule of energy. They have taken 0.25 moles. Therefore, energy will be also equal to 1/4. The value is equal to 57.1/4, 14.3 we have. Answer comes to be option C. Then, for a sudden reaction, delta H naught, delta S naught are 400 and 200 joule per mole, joule per mole per Kelvin. The process is spontaneous, and at which temperature the reaction is going to be non-spontaneous process. Now, for the reaction, they have given delta G is equal to delta H minus we have T delta S. The reaction is spontaneous. So, and the reaction is endothermic process. Delta H value is equal to positive. Delta H value is equal to positive, and reaction is spontaneous, means T delta S must be definitely more than delta H. When delta H is equal to positive, the overall reaction is spontaneous, means here definitely T delta S must be more than delta H. So therefore, equating T delta S is more than delta H. That implies T is more than delta H by delta S we have. Delta H by delta S we have, which is equal to delta H, that is 400 into 10 to the power of 3 by delta S 200 here. This value comes out to be 2000. It implies that at 2000 Kelvin or more than this temperature, the reaction is going to be spontaneous. The question is, which temperature reaction will be non-spontaneous? It should be lesser than 2000 Kelvin. Less than the value is given as option C. So therefore, C is correct. So since delta H is equal to a positive value and the reaction is going to be a spontaneous process, hence T delta S must be definitely more than delta H value. So T delta S more than delta H value. So T is more than delta H by delta S value. We got to be 2000. So implies more than 2000 degrees Celsius, the reaction is always spontaneous. The question is, temperature at which reaction is non-spontaneous, therefore lesser temperature, hence it should be 1990. We have option is C. Then, so answer is option C here. The amount of heat in joules for isothermal reversible expansion of 1 mole of ideal gas from initial pressure of 2 bar to a final pressure of 0.2 bar at 273 Kelvin is. So he's talking about isothermal reversible expansion for 1 mole of a gas. Now we have a formula for work done for isothermal reversible expansion, which is given by W is equal to minus, it is 2.303 N RT, the given here pressure, so the pressure will be here P1 by P2 we have, which is equal to minus 2.303 into N is given as 1 mole here, so 1 into value of R, it is 8.314 into temperature is 273 Kelvin, so 273 Kelvin into log of initial pressure is given as 2 bar here, 2 by final value is given as 0.2. So 2 by 0.2 comes out to be 10, therefore log 10 is 1. Hence the value will be, this value will be equal to minus 2.303 into 8.314 into 273, and this comes out to be minus 5227. Minus, this work done is equal to minus 5227 we have work done value. Now they are asking us, what is the amount of heat? What is the amount of heat? We know the work done there, we require heat. Now applying first law here, delta U is equal to Q plus W we have. And here isothermal process means delta U will be equal to 0. This is equal to 0, which is equal to, we require value of Q, and W has been found to be minus 5227 we have. Therefore value of Q will be equal to plus, it is 5227 we have. So answer is plus 5227. Answer is plus sign 5227. So answer is option A we have. Answer is option A. So it is coming from first law of thermodynamics itself. So work done minus 2.303 nRT log P1 by P2 substitution. We got the value of work done here. Then you have taken first law of thermodynamics formula.
Welcome to Deeksha Online. Today we are going to discuss objective questions from P block, that is 13th and 14th group elements. First one, which is not a mineral of aluminium. So we need to know the formulas of all these compounds. Anhydrite is calcium sulfate. Bauxite is Al2O3 2H2O. Corundum is Al2O3. Diaspore is Al2O3 H2O. So except the first one, remaining all are having aluminium in them. So therefore answer is first option, is not a mineral of aluminium. So anhydrite is calcium sulfate. So option is A. Then, the mineral of aluminium which does not contain oxygen, in that. Once again, we need to know the formulas of this compound. Already we wrote the formulas. That is bauxite, once again, Al2O3, it is 2H2O, diaspore, Al2O3, H2O. Gibbsite, Al2O3, 3H2O, cryolite, Na3AlF6. Cryolite is Na3AlF6, there is no oxygen atom in this. Hence the mineral of aluminium which does not contain oxygen is cryolite, that is Na3AlF6, option is D we have. So cryolite is Na3AlF6, no oxygen atom in that. So answer D. Then, with which of the following diborane does not produce hydrogen? We need to know the reactions between these compounds here. So diborane, so B2H6, if you take NaOH plus water, this H2O, with NaOH, it produces KBO2, it produces NaBO2, and then liberates H2 gas. If you take hydrolysis reaction, diborane plus take H2O, it forms, it gives us H3BO3, liberates H2. If you take HCl, it forms B2H5Cl, which is called chlorodiborane plus H2. When you take chlorine here, upon chlorine here, complete breaking of the molecule takes place. We get here BCl3 and then HCl. So except this, remaining all three are producing hydrogen with the reaction with the diborane. So answer is option B we have. So chlorine gives BCl3 plus HCl when reacts with diborane molecule. Then, so option comes up to be B we have now. Moisten boron is the straight away the straight question, that is a 95 to 98% pure boron itself is called amorphous boron itself is called moisten boron. So answer is option A correct here. So A is the answer for this. Then a bond that does not exist in diborane molecule So when you see the structure of diborane molecule, so boron, boron, hydrogen, hydrogen, two more hydrogens here, hydrogens here. So these two are normal bonds, BH bonds here. One more bond is BHB bond we have. So boron contains BH bonds are there. These are called BH bonds here. There are no BB bonds in this. We have BHB bonds are there. BHB bonds are there. We have even HBH also. Say HBH bonds are also present. There are no BB bonds in diborane molecule. So answer is option B. Next, which of the following is correct? Silicones are organosilicon polymers containing SiOSi linkage, which is correct option. It's having organosilicon polymers. R3SiCl, that is same, trialkyl chlorosilane on hydrolysis gives R3SiOSiR3. Let us see the reaction here. That is, when you take trialkyl chlorosilane, means it is a R3SiCl. First of all, it forms, that is Cl is replaced. So R3SiOH here plus HCl. And then two such molecules, means R3SiOH plus one more molecule, that is R3SiOH. They react to lose water molecule here. So H2O is lost. And so we get here R3SiOSiR3 then. So the bond contains SiOSi bond is present. So implies option A as well as B both are correct. So A and B are correct, means option is C for us. So silicones are organosilicon polymers containing SiOSi linkage. And a trialkyl chlorosilane and hydrolysis gives rise to R3SiO SiR3 molecule. So option is C. Then, which of the following metal forms protective oxide layer to prevent corrosion? It's a direct question. Aluminum forms alumina, a protective oxide layer on that. Initially it reacts, but it forms protective oxide layer. Further reaction will not take place here. So option is C here now. So C is the answer. Then the inactiveness of aluminium in the presence of concentrated HNO3 is due to the formation of, again same thing, it is because of the formation of alumina, which is Al2O3, that is a protective oxide layer is being formed here now. So option is D answer. Then that is D here. Non-planar molecule among the following. So if you see diborane, the boron is undergoing sp3 hybridization, and here the molecule carbon undergoes sp2 hybridization, benzene also undergoes sp2 hybridization. Boron also undergoes sp2 hybridization. sp2 hybridized atoms, the structures will be always planar structures. sp3 is always going to be a tetrahedral, so the structure is going to be always non-planar molecule. So B2H6 will be non-planar molecule. Remaining all the other things are planar structures we have. So sp2, 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 sp3. Therefore, these three are planar. So B2H6 is going to be non-planar structure. So answer is option A. TLI3 is an ionic compound which furnishes any of the following ions. TLI3. So TLI3, thallium, always exhibits +1 oxidation state because of inert pair effect. So therefore, when you take TLI3, this ionizes to form TL+1, and then it forms there I3- ion will be formed here now. So TL+1, stable state for thallium, +1 state, I3-1. Therefore, the option here will be I3-1. So answer is D option we have. So answer is D in this case. Then next one, option is, sorry, this is wrong option. Option is TL+1 and I3-. So option is here, A here. Option is A. Excuse me. TL+1, I3-1. Which of the following halide does not hydrolyze? Which of the following halide does not hydrolyze? If you see lead, silicon and tin, all are having vacant d orbitals in them. And carbon doesn't have vacant d orbital in that. So therefore, carbon does not hydrolyze here. Remaining all halides undergo hydrolysis. So CCl4 doesn't hydrolyze because of the absence of vacant orbitals on carbon atom. So option is C. C option we have. So CCl4 does not hydrolyze. Then, the correct order of carbon-carbon bond lengths in the given compound, CC bond lengths. So acetylene, triple bond, ethylene, double bond, graphite, single bond, benzene will be partial double bond character, ethane will be completely single bond we have. So therefore, is these two are having partial double bond characters. So when you are observing the bond lengths here, so CC single bond will be having 1.54 angstroms, say in the case of alkanes we have. If it is CC double bond length is nearly 1.34 angstroms. If it is carbon-carbon triple bonds in acetylene molecule, it comes to 1.2 angstroms here. And in benzene molecule, because of resonance phenomena, the carbon-carbon bond length will be equal to 1.39 angstroms we have. And in the graphite structure, carbon-carbon bond length comes to 1.42 angstroms we have. So least bond length is 1.2 angstroms we have, and longest bond length is 1.54 we have. So ethane is going to have, so therefore ethane will be having highest bond length, least is going to be acetylene here now. And therefore the order will be option, so acetylene, then ethylene double bond, then partial double bond character, and then comes ethane we have. In this one, benzene is having 1.39 and graphite has 1.42. 1.42 for graphite we have. Therefore, option is a B. B option we have. So, lengths are single bond 1.54, double bond 1.34, triple bond 1.2, triple bond 1.2. And in benzene, carbon-carbon bond length is 1.39 angstroms. And in graphite, it is 1.42 angstroms. So, answer comes to be B then. Then, which of the following is cross-link formation in linkage silicones we have? Cross-link. Cross-link means more than two oxygen atoms must be bonded. If you take this dozen, option A will not form any polymeric structure. It forms only a dimeric form here. And this can, there are two free oxygens are there. So, it can form cyclic structure, or else it can form even the chain type of silicone also. Chain or cyclic form B. And then D will not form any type of silicones because there is no silicon oxygen atom. And option C is correct because there are three oxygen atoms here now. It can form cross-linked type of polymer. So silicon bonded to three other oxygen atoms can form cross-linked type of polymer. So option is C we have then. C is the answer here now. Now Which are the following compound of lead is red colored one. So Pb3O4 is called, actually the name itself is red lead for Pb3O4. Pb3O4 is called red lead, so therefore the compound itself is red in color. It's actually a mixture of two compounds here. That is, it will be 2PbO plus it is a PbO2 together compound. This mixture itself is called this one. It's called red lead, which is a red in color. So Pb3O4. Option C, Pb3O4. Then silicon tetrachloride with reducing agent gives compound A, and on final heating gives the compound B. A and B are respectively. So silicon tetrachloride on reduction will form SiH4. So therefore, that is to say, silicon SiCl4 on reduction with lithium aluminum hydride, it forms SiH4. It forms, which again upon strong heating it will dissociate to form silicon and then hydrogen. It forms silicon here. So compounds are SiH4 and then silicon. So these two are there in option B, SiH4 and then silicon we have. So answer is B option. Thank you.